Hello friends, greetings from Finstudyclub. This is Ankur welcoming everyone to a very important and sometimes confusing session on the diluted EPS. Now this is one of the, a little difficult topics out of the total range, and things don't get more difficult than this in level 1, you know, at least in FRAs as I can say. And actually, the reason for that difficulty is the confusion, because we are unable to understand the context in which this particular topic of diluted EPS is being explained. So, what I've tried to do is, we have tried to, you know, explain the context initially. I'm going to throw a problem to you, and basis that, the solution is something that's going to come in the future slides. Okay, it will be a little numerical oriented, but before that, you got to look at the bigger picture and try and make a connect with that. So the problem that I have is the problem of an existing company who wants to raise more money, obviously, you know, it's like the next round of funding, and is presenting its case to the new investor. And you know, let's say you might not have looked at the equity investment so far. So one of the ways to calculate the market price is a multiple based approach. You're going to learn all that, you know, multiply P multiple the EPS. So, greater the EPS, greater is the market price of a particular share, and you know, greater is the value that the company can get from the new investor. So, the company has an EPS of $1. This is the basic EPS that we are saying. So, $1 comes here. There is a multiple of 10, you know, that the company is commanding. We will talk about multiple at the right time. Into 1. Gives you a number of $10. So $10 is the price at which the company is asking the new investor to invest. His budget being total $1,000. So 1,000 divided by 10, he is able to purchase 100 shares of the company. Okay, the company already had 100 shares. So 100 more overall, the company has now got 200 equity shares. Let us say at T0, new capital has come to the company, and that new capital has been contributed by the new investor. Now the challenge is, actually this wasn't known to the new investor, that the company has some bonds. Every company has some bonds, so that's fine, but those bonds were convertible into 50 new equity shares. What is this conversion option? This conversion option is one where a person A remains in a particular capacity for a particular period of time, and upon fulfilling some conditions, get access to some other instrument, pretty much an equity, you know, so without paying a fee. So let's say by paying a nominal fees in that sense. So let's say I have issued bonds to A, and A can get access to equity share, let's say after 2 months. Now what happened is, this wasn't told to the new investor upfront. The new investor thought that the company has 100 shares only, he'll be buying 100 more, so he's going to get a 50% ownership, almost like a stage of control. Okay, but to his bad luck, 1 month after his infusion, 1 month after the new capital being raised, the bond exercised the conversion option. If let's say we talk about A is equal to L plus C, the bonds were returned to the company, so bond will go down and new capital was issued. I want to ask a question, how much is the cash that has been generated out of this conversion option? Answer is zero. That means the invested capital, the base of invested capital will remain same. The base of the invested capital is going to remain same. So, in absence of any new capital being coming into this invested capital base, the total invested capital remaining same, the earning capacity of the firm remaining same, the profit that will be generated will remain constant. So, to the plight of the new investor, now there are 250 shares out of which he owns only 100. That means his ownership is going down to 40 from 50. But the profit remaining same, therefore 10% is his direct loss. Now try and understand, guys, that he would not have mind if new cash would have joined this capital base. The capital base would have gone up, more profit would have been generated, and of the greater pie, he was sharing a lower percentage. That would have been still okay because everyone is concerned with his absolute earning. But in this case, the percentage ownership is going down, but the total pie is not increasing because the new capital infusion is happening upon conversion. So this is basically the plight of the new investor, that there is no new capital inflow, therefore the invested capital doesn't go up, therefore the profit doesn't go up, and hence because of the low percentage, he has to suffer a loss. And the conversion option, when it would have been given to these bondholders, there must have been some favor that would have been taken. The favor may be in terms of a lower interest rate. So he wasn't there in the company when that favor was taken. But now when the cost is being borne by issuing some free equity, then he is part of it. So therefore, he wants to retain 50% of his ownership anyhow. This is basically, this entire jing-bang is happening because of the 50 free shares, that the company has promised to the bondholders. So what do we do with these 50 new shares that have been promised but they haven't been issued so far while raising new capital? So this is something which is called as a potential security. What is a potential security? It is a security which exists in non-equity form as of date. It could be an option, it could be a warrant, it could be a convertible debt, like in my example, or it could be a convertible preference shares. They are non-equity right now. But because of the already conditions being met, tomorrow or maybe any time in future, they are convertible into equity shares without paying any consideration. They are convertible into equity shares without paying any consideration. That's what the problem of the new investor was. The moment the consideration is coming up, the capital base is going up, the pie going up, and therefore the profit going up, the new investor will not mind sharing a lower percentage of the greater pie. But the challenge was, since there was no consideration coming up, that was, creating a lot of problem. So what do I do? What do I do with these 50 equity shares? I got to recalculate my hypothetical figure. I want to write two words. Hypothetical figure plus pessimist scenario. Now the new investor obviously is pissed off with the company, and he said that $1 is not that you have been earning. This $1 is basically considering the equity share base which did not have this 50, it was only on this 100. So either the company should have included this 50 also along with this 100 to calculate the earning per share before coming to me. That means the company should have diluted. If the number of shares will go up, then obviously the overall ratio will go down. The company should have diluted its earning before raising further new capital. And that's what gave rise to diluted EPS. Now, a little challenge here is that every convertible is not always dilutive. There are sometimes some convertibles which are anti-dilutive. What I mean by that is, let us say my existing EPS was coming at $1. This may be, let's say, made up of $100 of income divided by 100 shares. Okay, therefore I was getting $1 per share. There is a possibility that the bonds that we are talking about must have been paid some interest. Okay, if the bond will get converted into equity, that's what the problem of the new investor was, if the bond upon conversion upon equity is going to increase my denominator here, obviously, and therefore the ratio was being pulled down, the EPS was coming down, therefore the need for dilution was happening. But there is also a possibility that the saving of interest might increase the numerator also, because now the bondholder will cease to exist, therefore the interest that I was paying to them, being a bondholder, I will not have to pay to them, therefore I will save on some interest, and therefore my earning attributable to equity will go up. So basically, I will have to check on a case-by-case basis and divide the potential securities into the dilutive ones and the anti-dilutive ones. What I mean by that is, a dilutive what I have to do is, the steps are very, very simple and straightforward. I will have to scan for any potential equity first. Is there any convertible? Because if there is no convertible, there is no promises being made by the company, the new investor should not have any problem whatsoever. So therefore, I will have to first scan for some potentials. Then out of those potential, I'll have to convert them into dilutive and anti-dilutive by something called as an impact assessment. That impact assessment is basically a process of creating a delta upon delta. That basically means, I'm going to take an example for that. If this potential security was hypothetically equity since 1st of January itself, in the current year itself, what would have been the impact on my numerator of EPS and what would have been the impact on my denominator EPS? If this delta upon delta, called as an impact assessment, is lower than the basic EPS that I have right now, which is $1 in my previous case, then I will assume that this potential security is going to be a dilutive one. If the result of the impact assessment is going to be more than basic, I'm going to conclude that this is a anti-dilutive. What is an anti-dilutive security? An anti-dilutive security is one which, upon conversion into equity, will have the effect of increasing the EPS. Now, this is something my investor is not bothered with. This is actually a good news for the investor. Therefore, the investor has asked the company to calculate diluted EPS. What were the two words that I had written? The pessimistic scenario. Investor is not concerned with a happy scenario. He wants to dilute the EPS as much as possible before putting his own money. So therefore, I will have to calculate the hypothetical figure, because this is not the actual EPS. Actual EPS in the previous case was very clear. This is $1. But this has been diluted by some convertible that has been issued. So this is what the investor is basically trying to know. So, you know, I think enough of talking. Let's, you know, take this example, you know, straight up and find this out as to, you know, whether we'll be able to understand the concept or not.